Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord.
Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.
Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, O Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts. Hereby, you have given us life and immortality. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
When Jesus and his friends were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door, outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them that Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed is the coming kingdom
of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. Hear what the Holy Spirit is telling God's people.
Thanks be to God.
God is with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for the acts of love by which you have redeemed us through Jesus Christ our Savior. On this day, Jesus entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph, and was proclaimed as King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palm along his way. Let these branches be for us signs of Christ's victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King, and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns in glory with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
From Isaiah, "The Lord God has given me the that I may know how to sustain clearly with the word. Morning by morning he wakens. Wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me, therefore I have not been disgraced. Therefore I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Hear what the Holy Spirit is telling God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Let's read the psalm responsively, Psalm 31. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly.
For my life is wasted with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my home is consumed.
I have become a reproach to all my enemies, and even to my neighbors, a dismay to those of my acquaintance. When they see me in the street, they avoid me.
I am forgotten like a dead man, out of mind. I am as useless as a broken pot.
For I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around. They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life.
But as for me, I have trusted in you.
My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me.
May your face shine upon your servant, and in your loving kindness save me.
Second lesson is from Philippians, chapter 2, 5, and 11. Let the same mind be in you which is in Christ Jesus, who through he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself, and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore God has also highly exalted him, and gave him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. said,
"Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for you. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have them. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priest in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I can eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you to a large room."
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them. And they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, Jesus came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and said to one another,
"Surely not I."
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them and said,
"Take, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them. And all of them drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never drink of the fruit of the vine until the day I drink in the new kingdom of God."
When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to them,
"Even though all become deserters, I will not."
"Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times.
But he said that nothing.
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And all of them said, "Listen." They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be distressed and agitated, and said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake."
And going a little farther, Jesus threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
"Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want."
Jesus came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words.
after day, I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me, but let the scriptures be fulfilled.
All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following Jesus, wearing nothing but a loincloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the loincloth and ran off naked. The crowd took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priest and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against Jesus, saying,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.'"
But even at this point, the testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
"I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power, and coming with the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do you still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?"
The whole council condemned Jesus as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said,
"You also heard of Jesus, the man from Nazareth."
But Peter denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you are talking about."
And he went out of the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders. But again Peter denied it. Then, after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
"Certainly you are one of them, for
which each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified Jesus. The inscription on the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided Jesus, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself."
"Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"Listen, he is calling for Elijah."
And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to Jesus to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down."
Then Jesus gave out a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion, who stood facing them, saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly this man is God's son."
Yesterday, in Myanmar, 50 people protesting the military regime were killed by the military there. They joined about 350 already killed in that country since February 1st. Last summer, all summer, beginning with the death of George Floyd, between 14 and 25 million people in 40 countries protested his murder, pressuring cities to reassess their police oversight. Most of those demonstrating had been peaceful, despite vast numbers involved, and very few have been injured or killed. Many will remember 2011 in Tahrir Square in Cairo, as protesters brought down the regime of a dictator. Unfortunately, their replacements would not be a whole lot better. But protesters have shown their power to make change. Many of you will remember Tiananmen Square in 1989, or the Stonewall riots in 1969, a six-day campaign when people who were lesbian and gay decided they had had enough of being persecuted, even legally, and stood up for their rights. Or perhaps some of you watched the 1963 marches, March on Washington, for better jobs and for freedom for people of color, led by Martin Luther King. A few of you here will remember the 1950s when in South Africa they had protests where people just stayed home. They didn't go to work that day, and the country realized what power their African citizens really held. I'm pretty sure none of you remember the 1913 March for Suffrage. Though many of you probably remember the Pussyhead March not too many years ago to declare women's presence and authority and rights in the world. There was the boss. 1773, and there have been protests, well, all along in human history. Today we are remembering a protest march in Jerusalem around 30 CE, when a group of Jerusalem residents and visitors gathering for Passover, the holiday that our Jewish cousins are currently celebrating again, when they came into town and realized, wait, there is a new message and a new messenger. Let us go out into the streets and wait for him and see what is going to happen. And they took off their clothes and spread them in the road so that he wouldn't get muddy on this little donkey he was riding. And they shouted, Hosanna, which means, God save us. It wasn't a hymn and parade, it was a save us cry. And there they protested the regime that was entering the city on the other side of town through the grander gates and on a grander animal. Pontius Pilate, the governor, was coming into town to keep an eye on things because the Passover could throw some violent activities into the mix, and it was his job to keep the peace no matter what. And after all, the Passover wasn't like expecting Santa Claus or something. If you remember the Passover, as we will on Thursday, the Passover is about freedom, right? Freedom from oppressors. The freedom that Moses led the people who were enslaved in Egypt out and into a new life. Probably the Roman Empire was a little worried every time Passover was remembered again. So today, we remember a protest march. And the people who hailed Jesus as their king, some of them, no doubt, would later be found in that crowd that gathered before Pontius Pilate and shouted, now he's not the one, crucify him. But I have to think there were more who did not go to that particular event, who remembered the different message and this different messenger, one who was not going to dress in fancy robes. He looked like a guy from the sticks. He was from the Galilee. That was way out of town. Nobody important came from the Galilee. And yet, those things he did, those stories, they heard him. They heard him preach. They saw him heal. Maybe they saw him turn a jug of water into wine. Maybe they saw him raise a dead man out of his tomb. Oh, there's a reason to gather and shout, Lord, save us today. So they gathered in Jerusalem to protest. Christians who have continued to remember and follow this man, Jesus, have continued to lead protests in the world. I cannot help but think that all of those protests I listed earlier have in some way a connection to the followers of Jesus. The people who say, it is not all right to be treated as a tool for an empire. It is not all right for a dictator to kill you just because you're in the way. It is not what God wants for people to be enslaved or forced into labor they don't agree to, or have their children put into forced labor. It is not all right to let democratically elected governments be overthrown by power-hungry people. It is not God's will people should be discarded, because all are valuable to God. And if we see that is not the case, we will protest. Hosanna, Lord, Hosanna, save us. This Holy Week, we will have different opportunities to remember what Jesus continued to say and do that last week of his life. But the bigger picture of his story will not be known until next Sunday. I hope we will be back here safely to remember that the greatest protest of all was against the power of death, when God said, even death will not keep my children. It was funny that people threw their cloaks on the ground in front of him so he wouldn't get dirty, but his whole meaning of his life was to get dirty, wasn't it? God wants to get dirty. Walk in the mud with us humans whose very being, humus, dirt, is related to what we were made of. Jesus didn't come to stay clean and tidy or wear a nice robe. He came to get dirty with us and to protest when he saw what was wrong with the human condition, what was wrong with the political condition, what was wrong with the economic condition, what was wrong with the spiritual condition of people who had been beaten down and told they didn't matter. And Jesus came to say, no, you all matter. And I will show you healings, I'll pull off a couple of miracles if that will help, but mostly I want you to know that God knows you. God knows what you go through. God knows what it means to be pushed to the side and told, you are from the Galilee? Or, your religion is what? Or, you think you can do what, Jesus? Hosanna, Lord, save us. Save us from the people who would still tell others, you don't matter. Save us from the voice inside our heads that sometimes say, you're really nothing. Save us from the economics and the politics that would say, oh, some people deserve it all, and some people really don't deserve anything at all. Save us, Lord, save us from believing those words. And give us the energy to protest those who would teach against your love. Hosanna, Lord, save us. Amen.
In prayer, we place them.
life.
Amen.
As Jesus taught us, we make our prayer. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
Thank you.